It is my distinct pleasure to introduce a colleague and a friend, Marilyn Cuch, who is a senior lecturer in the School of Teaching Education and Leadership. And she comes to us from the wonderful Roosevelt campus. It's very beautiful. If you haven't seen her office, it's really nice, really great spot. So she'll be talking to us today, and her title is Indigenizing Your Online Teaching. Because you should.
Well, good morning. Can you hear me? Is everything working? Good, great. That's half the battle when we teach online, making sure you can see and can hear. What a pleasure it is to be presenting. This is the first time I've presented since before my 16-year-old was born by myself. I've presented by myself. So I'm happy that I finally I hit 50 this year, and I feel like I've got a few things I want to say, so I'm going to start saying them. I am from the Hunkpapa Lakota people in Standing Rock, in a Standing Rock Nation in North and South Dakota. My homeland is actually on the Missouri River, and my home community is the Little Eagle, or Liligo as we say it, in the South Dakotan talk. And I've been promoted to the director of the undergraduate secondary education program at Utah State University. But more importantly, I really enjoy teaching as a lecturer. I wanted to share with you these three areas. I want to talk to you about something that I feel is important. And I also know that many of you may find it would be helpful to maybe siphon it out if you're teaching students that are Indigenous, Native American, tribal, and all of the other titles that we have to have for some reason to be able to call us people of this nation and this land. We're on the northeastern band of Shoshone land, and what a pleasure it is. What a beautiful morning. And as we can see across the valley, that we've been given a day that we can learn, we can collaborate, and we can also begin to transform ourselves. I want to show you how to increase community and participation in your online learning communities. I want you to apply those in student engagement techniques that you find meaningful, and then also improve inclusive teaching and learning opportunities for students. So why the term indigenizing? Well, for one thing, I think it's kind of neat. I haven't trademarked it by any means, but I want to tell you a story because this is how I teach. This is my cultural pedagogy coming into action in my teaching pedagogy and how I see my role as a facilitator of learning. In my Indigenous philosophy of teaching, it's about a spiritual connection, actually. And I want to tell you the story of why it just didn't fit. I was sharing with Spencer Spotted Elk, who's going to present this afternoon with the rest of a group on indigenizing our classrooms. I want you to think of it as a really uncomfortable pair of shoes or a really, really tiny coat or a blazer that you have. And you put it on and it just does not fit. It's just uncomfortable, those shoes. They just don't feel right. And I'm going to tell you my story because this is where it all came from. I started to see that I wasn't finding joy, to coin Marie Kondo, who my 16-year-old loves, sparking joy in my classroom. And I thought, why am I doing that? If it's not sparking joy with me, I know it's probably not sparking joy with my students. So then I began to say, what's not working? So in my spiritual piece, I said, teaching is a spiritual act where you actually have to become the person that allows for the information to come through to make it impactful for that student. When we talk about our Indigenous beliefs and our Indigenous ways of knowing, it is an actual act of being selfless, that you know something, but someone else knows something also, and that you can build upon those in infinite ways. But you have to step back, be vulnerable, teach naked, as we've heard before, but also to see that something isn't working and I can make it better. So who can tell me how to make it better? It's our students. So I would ask vulnerable questions and say, tell me. So I would say, there's an invisible piece here that I can do. And I'm going to ask my students, what is it that I need to do? So I wanted to find out, why isn't my online class, my hybrid class is not as impactful or making joy in my life as much as I want it to be for my students. So I want you to know that there's a way of acknowledging that Indigenous perspective by asking the questions for your students' needs. Because ultimately, it's a service that we do to the university. We have teaching, service, and research in our triage here at Utah State. But look at our students as they went through COVID. My gosh, look at the background of this student. You can see, obviously, they enjoy plants. They found some, not a basement apartment, obviously, for plants. But they've got all this stuff going on in their life. So in my asking of questions, I wanted to find out, what do you enjoy about learning? What do you want to know more about? In my classes, I teach multicultural education and educational foundations, and I also teach assessment. Assessment doesn't sound too much fun, but it actually can be if you do it right. But I asked them all these questions, and it was before COVID that I started really indigenizing by saying, how can I make it meaningful to you? What is it that you want that you're not getting? Let me be the change instead of my students being the ones that have to be the change. So there's a cookie cutter, and different colors of dough are out there according to my student. And then all of a sudden, here I am. I have the same cookie cutter, just a different colored dough. And I'm going, wait a minute, whoa, this isn't working. I need to change my cookie cutter because my students aren't sparking joy. But it became an Indigenous piece because my teaching philosophy is a service. It's a spiritual connection with that person. It's making sure that I have figured out who are my students before I even get started. If you haven't met me, you'll probably get to know I really like to have a good time. Good time because I believe that if we know each other, then we can find connections. We can also create even stronger meaning and make more change together when we know each other better. So this whole Indigenizing perspective is rooted in tribal critical race theory. This is from Brayboy. And in the parts that I've done, and there's a lot of words on there, my husband's like, don't put so many words. And I said, well, I'm going to tell the story. Don't forget, all of these PowerPoint slides and stuff, they're going to be on the website for ETE, so don't feverishly write. Okay. When we talk about Indigenizing, we have to decolonialize. We have to pull apart and say, just like those uncomfortable shoes and that little constrictive jacket, that doesn't work. Those perspectives don't work in higher education or in education at all because it has been placed upon us to conform as Indigenous people. So in this critical tribal race theory, it means that culture, knowledge, and power are not kept within one entity, but they're actually examined through the lens and they're given out to others. So I am not the sage on the stage, nor are my students going to expect me to pour into the perfect vessel and then they go out and become secondary ed teachers. That doesn't work. We also believe that tribal philosophies, the belief systems, and the customs, traditions, those are so important. So if your students are doing Sundance right now, and classes start Wednesday, do not say, I'm so sorry you can't take that test because you missed that close date. They're praying and they're giving up their time and their fasting for us, for the universe to stay in connection. Now don't ask a lot of questions unless they want to, but give them that grace and allow them to be able to say that they get me. They want me there. And that actually happens in the Uinta Basin. We have Sundance coming up. And our students that are K through 12 get docked for not being there. That's wrong. So ask. Or long term, thinking about our own. The next one is stories. I told you stories. It's a legitimate way of conveying knowledge. allow them to tell a story. Give them an option for something other than a paper when you're seeing the historical trauma of colonialization still happening in our classrooms today and in higher ed, where students are docked because they didn't get that grammar right. But the meaning is there. Or give them another option of being able to show you by maybe having an audio recording, pictures with their language in there. So when we think of the theory and practice connected, it changes to that educational change. I'm here because I want to see a change. So I'm going to talk now about impacting, and I couldn't find any stock pictures, and my son, who's 16, will not let me take his picture. So I couldn't get him to do anything on that. But I want to just help you apply impactful student techniques. So another more stuff. Mullen Gonzalez, do you guys know about funds of knowledge? Okay, good, a few hands. Of course, Dr. Reed does. But funds of knowledge has to do with that we come with community and cultural and linguistic knowledge that's impactful to what the students can know and do and show you. Students meaning anybody. And when we place this around the recognition of place-based learning, remember, you are on Indigenous land. Acknowledge those people, because those Indigenous people, they come out of the woodwork, and not everybody has to have the phenotype. They are Indigenous if they're a descendant. And sometimes they're at different ways of knowing and who their identity is, and they also may be Indigenous to another continent, and it's still there, and they have these ways of being. So acknowledge that. Second part is storytelling, and then giving another storytelling back is just as impactful as a multiple choice true-false. But you can change it by way of asking them, how do you prefer to learn? Before you even jump into content, please do not just start. Here's your wonderful syllabus quiz. How many points are you going to get when you turn in your final exam? And that's really great. And we have to do that to make sure they know the expectations. But do more of, who are you? Tell me. I used to teach at Haskell Indian Nations University. It's a tribal college. Used to be a boarding school where they beat and tortured children. And then it turned into a, just full out, I'm going to tell the truth, right? We're going to tell the truth. But we also, we talked about at Haskell, what's your educational biography? You may change it. Maybe it's your scientific biography. I used to teach mathematics for elementary teachers. Tell me your mathematical autobiography. They would tell me horror stories of people teaching them, trying to. Yeah, if you're crying back there, yes. This is awful. I still don't get fractions, except when I'm trying to figure out blood quantum. But when you look at life experiences, it tells you so much more about who you are and what you can bring to the classroom. They're good. We know that. You're researchers. Come on. Good questions lead to good results and good data. It also tells us that there's community knowledge, languages, and abilities that you can tap into and use. So if you have students that you're breaking into groups, by all means, tell me more about the things that you like to do. Show me a time when you did, related on your outcomes, of course, did something, and then you can break them. It's going to take a little while. You got to really read, but you're reading about your students. Why are you asking the questions if you don't want to really know? Don't just make this look good so you can get really good evals. But as we all know, that's fruitful. Because you're teaching humans. Just because you have this seminal last final project and you've done it for like 15 years and it's because you really love it, does it really give you what they need? Because their learning needs are met there. So I want you to think about, to assimilate and survive. We have to assimilate and survive in higher ed, right? Right? But does that really make them good learners? I've talked to so many students and myself I was a biology and chemistry undergraduate student. I love science. Science, they have these parameters. In math, there's these equations. And everybody, you do, 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 and you get to the end. It was like I knew there was control in there because I knew I could get to that end because that was the parameters for that class. And when you think about that, there's something to be said about knowing how the rules of a class works. Then, and maybe there are some students, you're like, I just don't understand why this student doesn't talk. Hey, it's called intercultural communication. That student is respecting you respectfully or not looking at you in the eye. They never look me in the eye. I was a little kid, constantly, look at me when I'm talking, look at me when I'm talking. I was like, I'm giving you respect. We don't look you in the eye. We're showing respect. So there's different intercultural communications. Or maybe the student just comes in during office hours online and they really don't say much. Don't have any questions. They're just wanting to find out what it takes to assimilate and succeed. But they're also being interculturally appropriate and allow for you to show them, establish clear routes of communication. Like, would it be all right if I email you? Would it be all right if I call you? Oh, please don't call. I only have this amount of data and my family uses it, and I use it also for my internet to be able to upload my assignments. So maybe an email would be better. I can check that one today. All right. Then the other part is acknowledge a democratic learning space, because then they know that this is okay. That if I speak up and I say something from my own culture and how I see it that doesn't match with yours, there's no retribution. I thought we're in higher ed where we can say some things that may not make people happy. And we're not going to kumbaya and sit around and be happy about it. No, it's okay. Because I thought we were supposed to learn. So I want to share my stories or my culture. So increasing participation by way, online learning is through equity-mindedness. If you have not checked out J.L. Wood and Harris III, yeah, they have an incredible equity-mindedness perspective on online learning, and they're working with community colleges. But one thing I found was I was actually doing this. I was like, whoa, oh, it's called learning-centric teaching. Yes, I love this. This is what ETE wants us to do. We want to have belonging. So one way, post a video. Put your face there. Make sure that they know you. One time I posted an announcement. I had two glasses on. I had my close-up, and then I had my sunglasses, and the whole time I did the whole video, I had two glasses on. I went in to post it back into my announcement, and I went, oh my gosh, I had two glasses. So they get to know you, and they get to see that you are interesting. Look at their boards that you post for introductions, and really read it. And then I like to I do a spreadsheet of all my students, and I write interesting things that I've heard or read in their posts or what they submit, and then I do a shout out to them. Or I say, did you, I don't know if you've had a chance to do this, but if you have not seen what this student did or what this student said, it then says, hey, I have equity, I'm reading, I'm there, I'm online. And it allows for that student to say, wow, she actually read my post. She didn't just go complete or made a four, but they know you're there. It also allows for you, and those of you the AQ scholars, raise your hands if you're an AQ scholar. Come on now. Yes, making sure you check the microaggressions. Oh, it's so tiring, the microaggressions after a while. Especially as an Indigenous female, it gets so tiring. Just the little things. And if you're a student in those discussion boards and you bring up something and it's not, again, assimilate and succeed, then you get silenced. But that's not what you want in those discussion boards. You want it to be equitable, but you want to remember that it's there. Please say their name. Say their name the way it's supposed to be said. Don't say, do you have a nickname? I write it out phonetically. I want to make sure, even the Steffens and the Stevens and the, make sure it's right. Even down to, I had a student in Tooele, and she was Polynesian. It was gorgeous. And I said, tell me how to say it, so I will, because it meant something so beautiful. And that's that name. Our names are important. And when you build a community of learners immediately, then you say, oh my gosh, you got to check this out, because Kathleen can do X, Y, and Z so well, and Sunshine, you have got to, you guys got to work together, okay? And that's exactly what you want to do, where you're building it together, that they're a group, that we're learning together, that it's, again, like the geeky pedagogy. The grades are important, but it's about the learning and learning from each other in a democratic learning environment. And allow for a break. I actually put breaks in my class this semester. They don't even know it yet. They're going to go in there and there's not going to be, hey, how come there's not anything due this week? It'll actually say, you may take this week as a break or catch up, or if you want to move on to the next module, you may. Give them a break. Really, look at your user analytics. They drop out by week 4 because they're so overwhelmed with everybody. Give them a break and make sure that it's meaningful. Allow them that. They're still going to be there. I know they will. And then when you have an opportunity to create open educational resources, do it. Books are so stinking expensive. And if you don't have a scholarship and you are just, you're cash flowing this sucker and it means you're barely making it, then do that if you can. Or if you don't buy the whole textbook, just get the chapters if you can. Be cognizant of that. A lot of our students aren't eating. They're going without, or they're eating really crummy food, which is going to lead to health disparity issues down the line. And then their families. So remember that. Assess access to the internet. Ask them at the beginning, do you have a steady access to internet? Or I always go along lines of, you've just paid your student fees. Go to the university, the center. Print off there. Use the internet. That's high speed there if you can. They're open on Saturdays. Go there. Get it done there so you can work like this. Or here's another option. it.usu.edu.it has all these free Word programs they can download for a student fee. Don't buy the whole thing. Allow for them to know that. And this is from newly Dr. Devin Isaacs. Belonging is a human right. Isn't it? And make sure that you know how to budget time with online life too, because they have a life. They really only 5. Oh, I gotta go. Okay, here it is. I'm gonna go through these quickly. Office hours. Give them different times. Make it be a Saturday morning, maybe later at night. Good Lord, they don't work from 8 to 5 because they're busy too. The juice has got to be worth the squeeze, right, Marla? It has a sign with enduring understandings. Build it in that it's going to be there for longer. Group works, give them timeline, tasks, allow for them to know exactly what's expected of them. Call or email them. Maybe give them ideas for, hey, graduation is coming up. Maybe allowing for them to see ideas for scholarships because you know they're interested in something. And maybe they're just stepping the foot into your class. Let them know there's more. Invite feedback and look at your user analytics. Look how many page visits or when they drop off your videos because they're really stinky. Redo them. Announcements. Get things that are interesting to them. Interesting pictures. I always put something about myself. Marilyn's Monday morning motivation. Okay, the last one is to improve it, inclusiveness. Get the Teach course. Take it. It's here. And it's through Dr. Melissa Teehee's office. If you are needing more cultural competency, put that land acknowledgement statement in your course so it's there. They see it. Make sure that your outcomes are learner-centered because changing a perspective means that they feel like this is for them, not because I gotta log on to that class again. What is she gonna have me do? And instead of, I can't wait to log on to that class, what is she gonna have me do this week? And reflect on your students in the course. Look at your resources. Are they the same, maybe you're into superheroes. We're talking about that today. And so you have superheroes on everything, and they're like, wait a minute, people, maybe there's other things I could do. Video choices. And does your class feel gritty, where it's just a little itchy and kind of grouchy? Or is it welcoming? It looks good. It's like if someone walks into your house and it feels so good. Make a classroom like that too. And make sure that they're felt understood. Reach out. I know some students are like, I am good. I really am good. Okay, good. That's great. Check that one off. And then make sure that you have built relationships outside of your course, bringing in that content that leads into here's what you can learn and build on in their, maybe their professional life, or maybe they're going to grow into doing something else. Maybe they'll be a teacher because they take my class. Wouldn't that be great? And then finally, your syllabus. Make sure it's not just a bunch of rules, but everybody knows what's expected, because indigenizing means I know that I can succeed because I know the rules of the road. I know what's expected of me. And I know that I have a place in here. Identifying their place-based learning with that land acknowledgement statement is just an acknowledgement statement. Doesn't mean that that's it. Keep going. How can you make this more interesting from Logan students to Tooele students to Ephraim students to the Uinta Basin and down in our other areas? Everything is a little different. It's a wild, wild west out there in some places. But in some other ways, you want to make sure that there's different ways of engaging. So change it. Take more ETE stuff and get that and put that in. That's where I learned a lot of it. And make your content fun. I put little things in there, quirky things. Because I want them to see that I'm a human being. I make mistakes. Oh, let's redo that one. Or in a video, I will literally put retake, and then I'll redo it. And some of them will see it, and they'll go, we saw, that was funny. Easter eggs, little things that allow for students to say, she's with me. Or I have to redo it another year, but I'll put in something that reflects back on something I've read from a student and redo that in a video. So it's current, it's fresh. It's not just the same thing rolled over every year. And then make sure that your graphics and your video are interesting in those announcements. I'm going to say this, and then it'll be my last one. Timelines. Do you really need the 11:59 on Sunday evenings? Because you know you're not going to get to the grading till Wednesday. Penalize? Really? And then allow them to resubmit, because it's about learning. It's a lot of work for you, but come on, don't you want to get more learning, enduring understandings for the rest of their life in your content than just, I got the grade, just like what Jessalyn said this morning. And then finally, work sprints. I did a work sprint with AQ. Work sprints are, give them like an hour and a half where they meet you through Zoom. Everybody mutes their cameras, but they work on a project, the same project, or do a catch-up of the semester, and you could do it during your little break time. And everybody works on it, and then they have goals that you've written out, and then you do a check-in, and then at the end they've done something. Or maybe they just need a one-on-one, so do a breakout room where you and that student work together. Work that creates that more unique bonding together with your students, allowing for them to have one-on-one time with you and get their questions answered. So provide intentional care. You build that trust. Do frequent check-ins. Seriously, y'all are jamming in assignments at the same time, and they're not doing as good of a job as if you could stagger. You know, we always have it that way. Maybe smaller micro assessments would be better. And then give them tools for CAPS, the psychological services, because they pay for it in their student fees. And then give them learning tools that they can use in your classes to get better and to be able to use it. If you know of a way to do it, then help them. Remember, assimilate and succeed doesn't work. It's about us. We make that change. That's the indigenization of your classes. Piliamaye, thank you so much for letting me talk.